Okay, we're going to get started. I'm Gary Sherwood, Communications Director for the National Alopecia Areata Foundation. Welcome to our webinar for district or local office visits with your congressional representatives and senators. Today's webinar is an overview of the issues and asks we'll be discussing with our legislators. Philip Gogles and Andrew Orzak from the Health and Medicine Council of Washington will present this information, followed by a question and answer period during which you can address questions by typing on your screen. By now, I believe a number of you already know Philip and Andrea. They oversaw our last Hill Day in September and have also accompanied us on numerous other meetings in DC throughout the year. Philip is HMCW's legislative director and has extensive experience organizing and mobilizing grassroots advocacy efforts. And his expertise as a former congressional staffer has been instrumental in many of our recent successes. Andrea is a legislative associate who has been with HMCW just short of a year. But in that time has been closely involved in mass advocacy efforts on the Hill. Phil, Andrea, thank you for joining us. At this point, I will turn things over to you.
Thank you, Gary, and thank you everybody for joining us this evening or afternoon to get more information on local visits and some of the issues that we are focusing on and the asks that we have for our members of Congress. So first, I'm gonna just jump on into a little bit of Schoolhouse Rock to give a background for everybody to set up the reasons why we interact with the offices that we do. So we have three branches of government on the federal level, the executive branch, which is the president and the administration. They enforce our laws. The judicial branch, which is the Supreme Court and other federal courts, interpret the laws. And most importantly for us, Congress is the legislative branch, which creates and enacts laws that eventually do get signed into law. So what's important for us is the authority that Congress has. You know, it's all well and good to engage with the administration, but Congress is really the source of the ability to make a difference for our community. The most important thing is they have the power of the purse. So Congress decides how much federal agencies receive on a yearly basis, and they have to, on a yearly basis, allocate funding for federal agencies. Congress is where policy is created. So for instance, our bill that we're going to be talking about later on and creating a benefit for durable medical equipment, that policy item came from outreach with the, sorry, one second. Let's see what happened. Sorry about that. So Congress has the power to create policy. And in addition to allocating funds for federal agencies, has oversight to ask them if they're following through with the recommendations and encourages them to focus on other areas as well. Next slide, please. Thank you. So all about Congress. We have the United States Senate, which they are elected to 6-year terms. We have two senators from every state, which brings us to a total of 100 senators. It doesn't matter if you're a high population state like California or a low population state like Montana, North Dakota, or Rhode Island. You still have two senators who represent you at the federal level. The House of Representatives is different. We have one representative from each district elected to 2-year terms with a total of 435. So every 10 years, the number of districts in each state will change. Years ago, New York had as many as 45 members of Congress in the House. This go around, they only have 27 because of the shifts in population. Meanwhile, states like California over the years have grown because their population has increased. So the House of Representatives every 2 years is up for election. That's why they seem to be more of the raucous part of Congress. The Senate elected over 6-year terms, you know, you only have a third of the Senate up every election. Next slide, please. So what's important about Congress as well and the work that they do are the congressional committees. On the Senate side, we have the Appropriations Committee. They're the ones who fund, who make the decisions on funding levels for federal agencies. We have the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee. They focus primarily on healthcare. Everything that they do is in their name. They have a health committee. And then you have the Finance Committee, which has jurisdiction over tax laws and the Affordable Care Act. On the House side, you have the same Appropriations Committee who allocate funds for federal agencies. And then you have the Energy and Commerce Committee, which deals with healthcare. It's the complement to the Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee on the Senate side. And then you have the Ways and Means Committee, which is the primary tax committee on the House side, which is a complement to the Finance Committee. Next slide, please. So our federal health agencies that we engage with, we have the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. That's the federal agency where we're working to incorporate this policy change with our bill. And then you have the Food and Drug Administration, which deals with drug development. We have a close relationship with them. We recently had, not too long ago, a patient-focused drug development meeting with them to speak about the needs of the alopecia community and how FDA could be more engaged and helpful. And then we have the National Institutes of Health, which is the federal agency that does all of the research and takes the basic science, which helps us lead to better therapies and development. Next slide, please. Advocacy is very important to what we do, and it's very good that we have so many folks who are joining us today. Advocacy is important because we have a critical mass of support in our community. When we have our Hill Days, we have folks from all across the country who engage with different members. And when we have a coordinated nationwide effort, you know, we're able to contact members in different states who continue to raise the education on alopecia. And the more champions we develop from across the country, the more likely we are to get not only recommendations for the National Institutes of Health, but our bill passed, because then the leaders and committees see the more support our community has or our bill has, the more likely change will be and the more likely we are to get our priorities moving forward. Next slide, please. So the important question, what do advocates do? The most important thing is educating lawmakers. You know, they are 535 members of Congress in total, 100 senators, 435 House members. Not everybody will know what alopecia is, have heard of alopecia, or understand the needs of the community. So advocates mainly, and importantly, educate lawmakers about what is alopecia, what their story is, why it's important that these members take up this charge and be champions of our community. We raise awareness through personal stories, humanize it. Why is it important that, you know, you are in Washington or you're in their office talking to them about our issues, making local connections. All politics, as they say, is local. So Gary can attest to this. If you're walking around the Hill and if I were to try and stop Senator Dianne Feinstein in the hallway, she'd be less likely to stop for me, being a resident here of Washington. But once I say Gary's from the great state of California, she'll quickly turn around and engage in a conversation with Gary because he's a constituent and he is local. And we also ask for specific action at the correct time, such as co-sponsoring the bill or supporting increased funding for our federal programs. Next slide, please. So I'm gonna turn the presentation now over to Andrea, who's gonna go over how to connect with your senators, your House members, and setting up local meetings. Andrea?
Hi, so just to go over how to find your senators and representatives, the first slide that I have here just goes through a couple steps. And the first step is to visit the Senate website, which is www.senate.gov. Step two, conduct a search using the Find Your Senators pull down menu in the upper right corner. And then you can select your state and click go. And third, on the results page, there's a link to the senator's website and their contact information and links to an online contact form. However, some of these websites are not all the same, but they're all pretty navigable, so you should be able to find things pretty easily. For your representatives, you do a very similar type of search, except you go to www.house.gov. And then for the second step, you conduct the search using the Find Your Representative zip code tool, which is, there's a box in the upper right-hand corner, and you put in your zip code. Oftentimes, you'll find that maybe your zip code belongs to two different districts, so you'll have to put in your full address to find your specific representative. And then on the results page, you'll get a photo of your representative with links to their website and an online contact form and a local map. And as the fourth step says, your zip code might overlap with multiple congressional districts, and then it will allow you to enter your zip code as well as your address. And then thirdly, to make a visit, to visit your local office, you would call your representative district office and or the office is closest to you, and that's information that you could all find on their website. Going through that process that we just discussed, you can ask to make an appointment to meet with the representative themselves if they're in town, or someone on their health staff, which is like the staff that we would normally meet with. And then prepare for the meeting with materials and fact sheets on alopecia areata. I'm sure that if you contact Gary, he would gladly pass those along to you. And then step number four is to follow up with the staffer you met with via email and to stay in touch with them throughout the year, just by sending them like email updates and just stories about your life and how things are going for you. We do advise that during your meeting, you take a business card from them so you're able to accomplish this last goal. And if you have any questions or if you would like to visit your office in your representative's office in Washington, D.C., you can contact me and my email is on the slide. If you have any questions, also, well, you can always contact Gary and he can always get through to me. So,
thanks, Andrea. One thing I will add to that is if you are making a local visit, please let us know because it's important for us to connect the dots here in Washington. So if you go out and see, for instance, Kathy McMorris Rogers out in Washington, if you just let us know that you saw her and the outcome of the meeting and who you met with, we can go into her office here in Washington on your behalf and tell the staffer here, you know, our advocate met in your local office, they met with Joe, and they talked about these important issues. And then the staffer here will connect with the local staffer to get more of the information, more of the notes from the meeting, and we'll be able to close the loop on what's being done locally and here in Washington. So, jumping into what's happening here in Washington, we are in the first session of the 116th Congress. I think it's fair to say that Washington is a divided town. You know, there is a lot of gridlock here in Washington, but what's good for us and our priorities is that everything we do is truly bipartisan, so we're not getting weighed down in some of the partisan battles. You know, there was a flip in the House last year with Democrats taking control of the House of Representatives, but you still have Republicans who are in charge of the Senate, and you still have the president who was in the middle of his term, and we're looking at, you know, everybody gearing up for the presidential elections next year. So with that new division in government, it has provided some interesting events here in Washington, but we still are working closely with champions on both sides of the aisle about appropriations, about what we want to focus on for NIH, what recommendations we have. There has been also not as much of a renewed focus. If folks remember earlier in 2017, NAP was very active in preserving basic patient protections through the Affordable Care Act. There was a lot going on. And this year, with Democrats being in charge of one house, it's less likely that they will fully repeal the Affordable Care Act. Next slide. So just a quick review of some of our successes. There's a nice picture of Gary and Natalie there during one of our recent visits to Capitol Hill. We have had an expansion of the NIH research portfolio. We have, over the past few years, have had meaningful increases of $2 billion, $3 billion, and $2 billion more. So we've had $7 billion worth of new funding at the NIH over the past few years, which is critical to our success. We have, this picture is from a mini Hill Day that we had earlier in March. We have a very robust program that we have on the Hill beyond just our usual Hill Day every year, where we'll have Gary or legislative liaisons such as Natalie, who will come to DC and will make visits about the bill and about some of our other priorities. And the bill in the last Congress was H.R. 2925. We had 23 co-sponsors on that piece of legislation. And I will say that that is an enormous amount of success for our community. You know, this bill we weren't really involved in from the ground up with. We were looking to reintroduce our specific alopecia bill. And then we came across Congressman McGovern's bill, which was H.R. 2925, but there wasn't real advocacy being done on that bill. We took that on as an organization, and 98% of those co-sponsors were from the NAF community. So again, another sign of the importance of advocacy and how advocacy works, because they were constituents of these members who asked them to co-sponsor this bill, which is why they jumped onto the bill. Next slide. So some of our contemporary legislative issues, as I mentioned, NIH received another $2 billion increase in fiscal year 2019, bringing the total funding to $39.1 billion a year. We weren't caught up in the government shutdown that happened earlier this year. For the first time in over 20 years, the NIH bill was done ahead of time, ahead of the end of the fiscal year. So NIH has benefited from a full year of robust funding. We are asking for the current fiscal year, FY 2020, for an additional $2.5 billion increase for NIH's budget to bring the total to $41.6 billion. As we see the increases of NIH continue, the more different institutes such as the National Institute, NIAMS of Arthritis and Musculoskeletal are able to do more research into alopecia and are able to do more for the community. Again, healthcare reform, the Affordable Care Act is still law. We do not see an avenue where Congress, with the Democrats in the House and the Republicans in the Senate, where they will both agree to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. There is a current lawsuit that was filed by a few attorney generals from across the country, and a federal appeals judge has held that the Affordable Care Act is unconstitutional, but it's working its way through the court system, and we don't anticipate the courts, ultimately the Supreme Court, overturning the constitutionality of the Affordable Care Act. We still are very active in promoting the importance of protecting patients with pre-existing conditions. One thing that we've heard from offices, Republican and Democrat alike, are that they are very focused on protecting individuals with pre-existing conditions. One of the things that we mention is alopecia doesn't care if you're from New York, from Alabama, if you are a Republican or you are a Democrat. The importance of the alopecia community is for everybody. So we have done, in my estimation, a very good job, because we hear from offices that, you know, it is their desire, no matter where they fall on the healthcare spectrum of what the system should look like in this country, that it is important to make sure that individuals with pre-existing conditions are protected, that they're not being charged more than anybody else, that individuals are still being covered on their parents' health insurance until they're 26, that we're limiting out-of-pocket costs as well as lifetime and annual caps. Next slide, please. So we're also asking again for increased funding for medical research, and we're asking for support for our new bill. We are working on an updated version of our bill that we'll get into as well. But I really want to hit home the importance of the increase in funding. You know, there's a lot of work that the NIH does, but there's also a lot of work that they are unable to do because they're not funded at the level that they should be. We're very much involved in the larger patient community, and a high tide floats all boats. So we never want to ask, you know, take this amount of money away from other research and put it towards alopecia research, we say the larger the pie is for NIH overall, the bigger our slice is able to be through the direction of NIH as a whole, as well as NIAMS and other federal institutes. Next slide, please. So again, NIH is the world's foremost organization supporting biomedical research. We have had specific alopecia recommendations to increase our research portfolio. The more funding they get, simple math, the more money they have to spend, the more that they're able to spend on increasing the research that's being done. We're also asking for continued support of the FDA research into drug development. As I mentioned a few years back, we had a great meeting specifically on alopecia and the development of drugs for treating alopecia. We have a report from that meeting, but we want to continue to make sure that FDA has the resources to continue to support drug development for treatment of alopecia. Next slide, please. And the star of our show, what will be our updated bill? To give some background, durable medical equipment, the definition of durable medical equipment are products such as crutches, oxygen tanks, prosthetics, but cranial prosthetics are not explicitly defined in the infinite wisdom of federal bureaucracy. So what our bill does is it changes the definition to include cranial prosthetics, which are wigs, to allow individuals through Medicare to have them covered. We know that private insurance often looks to Medicare to see what they are and are not covering, and will most times base their decisions on what they will then cover after what Medicare does. You know, this is something that in the last Congress was one page front and back of a bill. It is a common sense bill. I can't tell you how many offices and members I spoke with that we would share the bill, and they looked at it and they said, that's all, it's common sense, sign me up. You know, we're not looking at some, you know, other health related bills that are hundreds, thousands of pages long. It's a very straightforward bill. We want to make sure that cranial prosthetics are covered as durable medical equipment through the Medicare program. And we don't want to get into the discussion of cosmetics, because it's not cosmetic. And we do have a process in which individuals would get a prescription from their doctor saying that they do have, for medical reasons, a cranial prosthetics, and we hope that Medicare would then cover that. So we have, in the last Congress, we had Congressman, as I mentioned, Jim McGovern, who was the lead on it. We currently are working with his office again on reintroduction. We also are working with Congressman David Schweikert from Arizona, who's a Republican. And for folks who may not understand the political dynamics of that, Congressman Jim McGovern is a very liberal member from Massachusetts, and Congressman David Schweikert is a very conservative Republican from Arizona, who's a member of the Freedom Caucus. So we have two members on the polar opposite of the political spectrum, yet they both realize the importance of this bill and the importance of leading this in Congress. We have had some great discussions as well on the Senate side with members such as Senator Stabenow from Michigan, who are taking a look at this as well. So this is where hearing from their constituents really does make a difference. If Senator Stabenow hears from a large group from her state in Michigan saying, Senator, we hope that you take the lead on this on behalf of your constituents here in Michigan, it is more likely to push them and inch them forward to leading this on behalf of their constituents. We are working through the appropriations process currently here in Washington. So we do anticipate that, you know, sometime over the summer, definitely before our Hill Day, that we will have a reintroduced bill. And our big ask for Hill Day is going to be, please co-sponsor our updated bill. Now, for folks who are on the webinar tonight, if you would like to go meet with your member locally, we can still talk about this. We could still share the fact of, with them, that this was a bill that was introduced last year. We have the information, a copy of the bill, some of the other materials that we used in the last Congress. And it's important to raise awareness with them and let them know that we are working on reintroducing the bill. So I don't want folks to think that because we don't have a bill yet, you can't go meet with your member locally. Absolutely, go meet with your local office, educate them about alopecia, educate them about the priorities for the National Alopecia Areata Foundation, what we're asking for an increase in funding for NIH, what we're asking for to continue protecting patients with pre-existing conditions and our four pillars of patient protection. Encourage them to, once we have our bill introduced in the House and the Senate, to show leadership and become a co-sponsor of the bill. And the information from the last Congress, you'll be able to share with them, letting them know we don't anticipate major changes to the bill. So the idea will still be the same, to reclassify cranial prosthetics as durable medical equipment. So with that, I will say next slide, and I believe I am going to turn it over to you, Gary.
Okay, thanks very much, Philip, Andrea. So you can just see on this slide here, we have our annual Hill Day coming up on Thursday, September the 12th. Please respond to the official notice, which will be coming in May, if you would like to be considered. As most of you know by now, we provide your travel expenses and your hotel. And if it were up to me, we would take everyone who wants to come. But it's not up to me. We can only afford to take so many people with us. So when you get that invite, please, again, get back to me right away. Let me know you would like to be considered, and you will be notified. At this point in the presentation, we are now going to open the floor up to your questions. They can be addressed to us by typing onto your screen. And we already have one question here, which I'll read aloud. It says, if we had a member of Congress who was on the last bill and we want them to be on the new bill, when is it going to be reintroduced? And Philip, I believe you mentioned that in your presentation. It's going to be this summer. The bill drops again with a new number. Is that correct?
So that is our hope and our goal. But I do want to caution folks, don't take my word as gospel. No matter how much I try to see the future as clear as I can, I don't see any reason for the bill not to be reintroduced by the summer. We have had a conversation with Congressman McGovern's office, but we have been moving through the very busy appropriations time, where these offices have just been flooded with requests for funding or different programs. So once that dust settles, which we anticipate will over the next few weeks, we'll be able to revisit with them and find out where they are in terms of the process and figure how we can move them forward. We have definitely indicated to them that, you know, we want to make sure that this bill is introduced as soon as possible, because we have many folks in our community who are ready to engage with their members. And I will say to folks, if you do have, if your House member was a previous co-sponsor in the last Congress, you don't have to wait for the new bill to be introduced to revisit them. You can go see them next week and say, you know, Congressman Smith, you were a great champion of ours in the last Congress. You co-sponsored our bill. I just want to update you. You know, we are working on a reintroduced bill. We expect it at some time over the next few months before I'm back in Washington in September for Hill Day. We don't anticipate drastic changes to the bill. We hope that you will again show leadership and become a co-sponsor of our updated bill. And I look forward to reconnecting with you once it is introduced. And then it's a good way, because with the new Congress, there are a few staff changes where folks have moved on to different offices. Especially with 100 new members of Congress, a lot of folks have moved around the Hill. So you might encounter a staffer who is brand new to the office, who now would be a great time to educate them on our priorities and then circle back with them when the bill is introduced. Or you may have a situation where somebody who previously handled or you previously met with, if it's a new member in your district, you know, you would go in and say, you know, this district is very passionate about this issue. The previous member was a co-sponsor. We hope that you will co-sponsor as well. But definitely still make those connections now, so that way once the bill is introduced, we can follow up with them and it's less of a sell to them, because we already discussed the issues with them now.
Okay, very good. This is an interesting question here, kind of about process, I guess you might say. Can two bills be introduced for the same cause using different congressmen to increase the chances of passage?
So I'm going to answer that two ways. First is we will have two versions of the bill just because there are two houses of Congress. We will have one bill that's introduced in the House of Representatives, and that will be a bill by Congressman McGovern and Congressman David Schweikert. So that's one version of the bill. The second version of the bill would be introduced on the Senate side, and it would be the companion bill. So they would be similar pieces of legislation, but introduced in both the House and the Senate, because in order for a bill to become a law, you would need it to be, it would have to pass both the House and the Senate. So if we had our House bill passed, we would then have to get our Senate bill passed. They would work out the differences amongst themselves, and then it would get signed by the president. We wouldn't have four members of the House of Representatives introduce two separate pieces of the same bill, though, because they would say you're duplicating what your intent is, and they would just blend it into one bill, if that answers the question.
Let's see, next question. Do you need another senator to sponsor the companion bill? I think you mentioned your presentation that we've been looking at Senator Stabenow, but would we also be looking for other senators to perhaps do this?
Yes, because everything we do is bipartisan, we look for a Republican and a Democrat to be leaders on the bill. So we are looking at possible Senate Republicans to be leads on the bill. And it's a term of practicality as well. You know, the Republicans are in charge of the Senate. Having a Republican senator lead the bill increases the likelihood that it will be passed in a Republican Senate. If we just had a Democrat bill in the Senate, that's less likely to move forward because Democrats don't control the floor or the process. So we are working to identify a strong Republican champion who could work with Senator Stabenow as possibly the lead Democrat on moving this bill forward. So if we have folks who are on the webinar who live in a state with a Republican senator and you have a strong connection to them, definitely reach out to Gary and let us know, so that way we can explore that option and connect with their office here in Washington.
Okay, and this question here, I don't know if this is exactly legislative, but let's see. Who will supply the wigs? Where are they coming from? So I guess that relates to should this bill pass. The wigs would come from the same vendors you would normally get them from. The passage of this bill would mean that Medicare would then be available for coverage of those wigs. That would be a significant change that would go into effect if this bill were to pass. And it appears those are all the questions we have. This webinar will be recorded, and we will provide a link to the recording shortly. We want to thank everyone again who joined us. This is the largest audience we've had yet for one of these webinars, which we do every year. I hope you got a lot out of it. And as always, if you have any questions, please feel free to email me at gary@naf.org. And okay, we're now getting a couple late questions, so we'll answer these very quickly here. Senators Van Hollen and Cardin of Maryland were interested last year, but need to hear from more Maryland constituents. What's the best way to coordinate with Maryland and Virginia colleagues? You basically, if you want, you can email me, help you guys accompany each other. Although, again, as I believe Phil touched on, it's good if you're a constituent, they're much more likely to listen to you. So if you're from Maryland and you bring in someone from Virginia with you, I don't know if you're going to get as much traction, if you understand that. And vice versa, if you're a Virginia person, it's probably best to bring in other Virginia constituents. And let's see. Also, why don't we contact private health insurance companies too? Well, the logic is that once Medicare initiates coverage of this, that's then going to spur on the private insurers to also provide similar coverage. This is sort of priming the pump, as it were.
Gary, can I just answer that first question?
Please, go ahead.
So in terms of, you know, being here in D.C., we're in a distinct position because we do have, you know, the whole DMV where you have D.C., Virginia, and Maryland. And, you know, we do have folks that work together across the state and federal lines. I would say if you want to get involved and meet with the Maryland senators, definitely reach out to Gary because our strategy is different depending on who we're talking to. You have Senator Van Hollen, who is a member of the Appropriations Committee. So his jurisdiction is funding. how much NIH would get, what recommendations we can include for FDA. He used to represent NIH when he was in the House. He's a strong champion of NIH and the work that they do. FDA is headquartered in Silver Spring, so it's relevant for both Senator Cardin and Senator Van Hollen. But Senator Cardin is a member of the Finance Committee, which would have jurisdiction over our bill. So if we were to go in with some folks from Maryland, you know, it'd be helpful for us to know here in Washington, Andrea and myself, so that way we could accompany you guys, one, and two, kind of tailor our ask. You know, if we're talking to Van Hollen, we're going to focus more on NIH, FDA, the importance of funding. And if we're talking to Senator Cardin, we're going to let him know this is what we're looking to do legislatively. This is how we could use your help. And both offices will defer to the other, depending on what you talk about. Van Hollen will say, you know, that's a finance issue. I defer to Senator Cardin because he's a senior member of the Finance Committee. And Cardin will defer to Van Hollen because Van Hollen is an appropriator. In Virginia, you have Senator Mark Warner, who's a member of the Finance Committee. So it'll be the same thing. You know, Senator Kaine would defer to Senator Warner in terms of Finance Committee matters. And Senator Kaine is a member of the Health Committee, Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee. So Warner would defer to Senator Kaine on health-related matters. But those health-related matters do include NIH, FDA, and some of these other initiatives. So I fully encourage folks, you know, if you have a group from D.C., Maryland, and Virginia, some kind of mix of that, you know, we can definitely do a day where we connect with all four Senate offices, as well as maybe some House members as well to discuss these issues. But we're happy to do that.
Okay, real good. And we got one more question here. Can we partner with wig companies to push for more support for the bill? I don't know. What would be your take on that, Phil?
I personally would not have them in the room because I think then it would give off the appearance that our community is doing their bidding. If folks have good relationships with some of these companies, that's great. But I think it's important that these offices realize, especially when we're talking about Medicare policy, that it's a constituent community issue. And it's not that, you know, we're going in or giving the appearance that we're going in at the behest of a company who is looking, you know, if this is covered, then they would be able to sell more product or to generate more revenue for themselves. I think it's important that we keep it as, you know, a patient community. This is something that, you know, is important to us that would be greatly beneficial to us when we have some of these discussions, because it has been discussed in some of our previous meetings, you know, just the different qualities of wigs, the ways some companies are better to work with than the others, and some of that anecdotally. But I would say we should keep this more focused from the specific patient community.
Sounds good. All right, thanks. All right, looks like those are all the questions we had. So once more, I will say thank you. And again, if any questions to you come to you afterwards, please feel free to email me at gary@naf.org. And thanks once again, Philip and Andrea, for joining us. Thanks to everyone who made time out of their day to be on this call. And we look forward to a really terrific year in legislative action. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.